Welcome back. Well, quite clearly, what's the cynosure of the market right now are the guys who have hit this big deal, the deal between IDFC Bank and Capital First, whereby Capital First will merge into IDFC Bank. Significant because one deal just fell through in November last year, October, November last year, and therefore to come back with such speed for another deal was important. Also important was the speed with which CNBC TV 18 reported this deal, first on Jan 8th, first to the world, and thereafter every single day we kept giving you updates, and here it is. Nisha Podar and I caught up with the key people behind the deal, Rajiv Lall, Managing Director CEO of IDFC Bank, and V. Vaidyanathan, Exec Chairman of Capital First. We began by asking him what were the regulatory requirements now that the two entities will have to be merged. Does the law require IDFC to bring to keep their stake at 40 because it will fall to 38?
We don't intend to seek regulatory dispensation. I don't think that it will be a big deal for IDFC to actually claw back to 40%. So that's the intent at this time.
Okay, so it will the combined entity will issue more shares and...
No, it will just buy, IDFC will buy in the market.
Oh, okay, okay. What about Warburg? What do the rules require in terms of Warburg's... I mean, it has to be 5% or below in the new entity. So would they have to sell out?
The current stakeholding is about 36%. Mm. Through this deal, they'll come to a little more than 10%, maybe about 10.3 or 10.4%. And to that extent, they'll probably have to come down to 10%. Now, the norms are at 5%, but yes. I think the system is hopeful based on the synergies we want to demonstrate and the future long-term path we want to show. I think they're hopeful that they will get an approval for 10%.
So there will be regulatory dispensation requests?
Not dispensation.
But it should be regulatory, you know, they should probably give them a window to deal with that situation.
But, then you are also saying that Warburg Pincus wants to stay on as a larger shareholder in the merged entity. They are not looking at monetizing after the merger as well.
That's absolutely true, actually. See, Warburg Pincus, as you know, has had an absolutely dream run with Capital First over the last, say 5 years. They really believe in the business model. They back the management very strong. So the sense that we have from this is that they will continue to back the story for many more years to come. And they are very much in.
So much depends on RBI allowing them to stay at 10%.
Allowing them to get to 10%. As I said, it's we can't prejudge the regulator. We could respect their view.
But there are precedents.
Yes, there are precedents. For example, they had a 10% stake in Kotak Mahindra Bank, for example.
Right, exactly right. So if I could just add, the regulation is that subject to RBI discretion, an investor, single investor, can own between 5 and 10%.
Okay.
All right.
So
and
it is their discretion.
Mr. Vaidyanathan, you also will land up owning a very small minority stake in the merged entity by way of your stake in Capital First. So as the CEO, as per the regulations, you'll have to let go of that, and also your CEO position will have to be approved by the RBI.
That is correct. Even my position has to be approved by the regulator. We are hopeful for that. And as far as stakeholding is concerned, you know, say about 3.5 to 3.6% or somewhere in that zone, I don't think that should be any bother at all for anybody, certainly not. And in fact, it actually demonstrates, I guess, both to the investors that I'm personally also as committed to this institution for the growth in the long run.
So there is no regulatory rule against you owning, regulation-wise, you just have IDFC having to buy 2 percentage points from the market and Warburg getting an approval.
That's about it. And I stay where I stay.
Okay. Yes, of course. Okay. Well, now to come to synergies. Mm. Dr. Lall, what do you perceive as synergies?
So synergies are, there are several levels. So I'll come to the financial ones in a minute. But they start in the software domain. So one, there is a complete alignment in terms of strategy. Our stated strategy is aggressive retailization. This merger offers exactly that.
But only in assets.
Correct, but it offers a huge number of additional customers, 3 million customers, that are in a customer segment that are actually more potentially liabilities rich. Mm. How do you actually generate liabilities from customers? You can do that
You can try and build a liabilities business that is completely disjointed from the asset side. But actually the customer doesn't see a bank like that. The customer would like to have a holistic relationship with the bank. So if you offer a product on the asset side that they really appreciate, there is every chance that you will actually be able to generate liabilities from the same customer base. So that's a strategic fit. Second, there is intent, and that's very important between the two of us, which is build the institution.
Of course, but can you, do you, how many customers do you promise in terms of liability, Vaidhi?
Okay, now listen here.
3 million retail customers, you said? No, 3 million bank accounts?
No, Lata, actually, it goes a little deeper than that. It's not 3 million customers alone. It is the capability to originate 3 million customers, and it's very important. Remember, in 2010, we had just a 94 crore rupee retail book, and today we are 23,000 crores. Every month, we are adding a large number of customers in the retail space. So when you carry this capability to the new institution, and on that platform, you scale it up. Secondly, in lending, as you know, it's not about lending alone. You've got to get it back. So we have developed some very special capabilities of doing two things. One, access a particular part of the banking system which is currently not addressed is important. And two, do it in a very high quality way where NPS are low. It's 7 years running. Our net NPS is 1%. That says something.
Right. Mr. Vaidyanathan, a lot is riding on you. In fact, the market is really looking up to you for the retail growth of IDFC Bank. Now, you have really originated a kind of business which will give a lot of cross-selling opportunities and the retail portfolio and assets to the bank. But as far as getting deposits are concerned, Kotak Mahindra Bank, Yes Bank, at higher rates are also struggling at this point. What is your strategy there, and what is the timeline and the target you're looking at? Because markets are very keenly watching out for these targets.
I think it's an absolutely good question, and I think probably one of the very most important questions. In my opinion, when you look all around us at the grassroots level, you see shopkeepers, you see people, you see employees, etc. You just see there is so much opportunity. It's everybody needs to keep the savings somewhere. Number two, if you see the Indian economy's growth over the next 10 years, I just read a report that Morgan Stanley report talks about 6 trillion economy in 2000, and we are 2.3 trillion today. Now, where is the extra 5 trillion going to be financed from? And where are the savings going to come from? They're going to park it somewhere. So if we develop a product where the customers have confidence in us, we have a relevant product, and we open branch structure that can allow customers to come and put the money with us and have a digital strategy, I have no doubt in my mind that we will raise deposits. It's a big play on
Will
the Indian store.
Will it require another inorganic play from your part?
Not necessarily at all. In fact, I'd say, this whole merger has to be seen in the bigger picture. The bigger picture is that Indian economy is going to say to become a, say, 7 trillion in, say, 10 years. Okay, 5 trillion to be created, I have a big piece in that. We are not the last bank to be created in the country. Maybe there are 40 banks here. Maybe we're the 41st on the liability side. But 100 more to come. So it's a very big story to play out for.
That's why they're not very confident of creating retail liabilities. But there are more issues. You know, their current and savings account combined together will be much less than 5%. NPA pressures, all those questions to the two gentlemen in a minute after this break. Welcome back. Nisha and I quizzed the two gentlemen on how much more they think the combined entity should get, should borrow in rupee terms to reach 4% CRR and 21% SLR.
We'll need 6,000 crores.
Okay.
But we already have a little over 2,000 crores in excess SLR CRR sitting with us. So we'll need about 4,000 crores.
So you'll have to raise it.
We'll raise it in the market.
Okay.
We have a very, accomplished treasury operation, so we should be able to do it.
But that'll tell on margins, won't it? You will. That'll be your baby.
Okay. Well, see, these things are marginal in the scheme of things in initial run. We should look at this bank.
But initially, you start with a tough margin problem.
It'll always be a tough job in the initial phases on many fronts for that matter. Okay, fixing your liabilities over a 3-year story, of course, it's not going to be an easy job. I recognize it's important, it's difficult, but it can be done. I recognize that there may be a few other challenges along the way. But The issue is, what do we look from a 3-year standpoint of view? So we should not really get worried about.
No, I take your point. I'm just looking at the current 3 years because the share price will reflect maybe 9 months down the line kind of entity.
Share price
may not look at 3 years down the line kind of entity.
I can't prejudge the share market, but all I can say is that I got to do what I got to do.
Okay.
If I got to put 500 branches, I got to go and put it. And the results will come when they come.
That was the next question. How many of your current offices can straight away be added as branches, you think?
Okay, we think that combined together at our existing branch network, we'll probably have 195 branches.
Okay.
But the long story is, let me say a little longer term story, is not to stay where we are. Now, if we get very focused on the quarter-on-quarter profits, we will never invest and we will forever be stuck in a funk. Our feet will be in clay. If we've got to open branches, we've got to do it. If it costs expenses, we've got to do it. And we should focus on what we can get out of those branches, how we can cross-sell to our customers, and how finally we can improve the value proposition for our customers in a composite way. If we achieve that, value will come. Investors will reap the rewards.
So synergies and retail growth is what market is banking on. But in the medium term, while you achieve that target, Mr. Vaidyanathan, the key question here is the margin depression. And here I would like to come back, apart from SLR, CRR, as well as the PSL requirements, there is also the credit cost, because you have a certain criteria of NPA, which is on the lower side. But when it comes and merges with the bank, will it really depress the margins as well?
I have to answer this question very specifically. I just take you to capital first. When we started, we were posting 5 crores a quarter of profits. Not long ago, 5 years ago. 5 crores a quarter. At that point of time, if I got stuck saying that, oh, it's only 5 crores, I can't invest, I won't be a 75 crores a quarter profit today. I got to do what I got to do. So here, to your question, therefore, I'm not really focused or fussed about what the first quarter's profits are going to look like. Am I going to be down? Am I going to be up? That's not the way to think. And we can never build big institutions with that thinking. So your question, I will not focus on the immediate margin this quarter or 1 year. I will start building the organization and build the infrastructure, get the organization, get the products right, and grow the organization, and the results will fall in place when they fall in place.
Okay, just to continue that priority sector, how much of your loans will already qualify for priority sector? Will the merged entity meet?
Yes. In fact, I think we will add to the priority sector, because we are in excess of 40% is our priority sector. So in fact, our priority sector drag to the process is zero. In fact, we are a contributor of priority sector to this contribution.
So how much? By how much?
We are excess of about 45% of our book is priority sector.
But PSL benefit is coming. One thing which may just have an impact on your margins in either ways, which I need to understand, is also that Capital First as an NBFC is also financed by other banks. Now it will all be financed by the bank you're merging into. OPEX for retail, looking at that dynamic, what will offset what? The cost of merging or the kind of benefit that you get out of the spreads that you will make?
So, you know, the bank's incremental funding cost is about 120 basis points lower than Capital First standalone. So that's as of today. So there's some immediate financial synergy, which will only get accentuated over time. As Capital First's high cost fixed rate liabilities drop off, and same with IDFC Bank. So again, to reinforce what Vaidyanathan is saying, that in 24 to 36 months, without actually doing anything, just by the evolution of our liabilities structure today, you will see immediate improvement at that point in our margins. Other point, I would like to emphasize from our perspective is that, see, Capital First have built a business in a retail segment that actually offers superior yields. So when you look at the combined entity, that's the logic for the retailization, that you by improving the asset yield, you are actually improving the margin. Then you can decide how much of that you want to invest.
You see, the retail business as such is, while it's great, it gives stability of earnings and all that, by the time you get the systems right, get the customers to accept your brand, get the processes, get the credit scoring models and technologies, get the whole architecture together, it takes decades. So that decade-long process has got overnight integrated into this piece. That's the way to think about it. If you look at operating cost of funds differential, I'd say that...
I still think it takes lesser time to prove to retail assets, and it'll take much longer for retail liabilities. So that issue will remain. Okay.
Yeah. Just one more question to that. So net-net, you're saying that medium term, 24 to 36 months you're giving. Is that the timeline also given for this transaction to be EPS accretive?
No, let me just answer that question.
See, because most of the brokerages have been saying that the kind of cost pressures that may really come in. So if
let me
you can give
me
when are you
let me put it straight. We think there are some instant synergies in the consolidated institution, in the way the stability of the organization comes together, in the way we are intending to grow the balance sheet. Now, with regard to the specific EPS and so on and so forth, I would really request people not to get too excited at that story. I really don't want to, because that's not the picture for tomorrow morning. If you're a three-year horizon on Capital First, I say you'll be very, very happy. But if you're a one-year story and you're going to be looking at the microscopic numbers of the two, I don't know. It's your own perspective.
So broadly, what would be the EPS accretive timetable?
I can just say that there are no cost immediate synergies, because all the people are going to keep the jobs. This is a new, this is a retail machine, that's a wholesale machine, the two are coming together. Okay. The value is going to come. His high-cost liabilities are going to take time for it to wipe out, and that's going to take a 3 to 5 years storyline.
Okay.
Our storyline is going to get funded by the retail balance sheet, but there's going to be a CRR lag. So I don't want to confuse anybody. There are some ups, there are some downs, but the story is together, coming together in 3 years, and I think if you take a three-year story, you'll be very, very happy. If you take a one-year story, it will play itself.
Vaidyanathan, if you could also quickly take us through the board composition and the management changes required now.
We have broadly had an understanding between us that how the board structure will look like. Basically, it will be board members from both organizations coming together. And then we will work out appropriately at the appropriate time what the composition
will
look like. The chances are that they probably retain one seat, but we still haven't worked out the precise details.
So that will change, and the management as well?
Well, as far as management, I'm heading the institution, and then I'll play my, put the pieces together. My whole objective is to figure out how I'm going to get maximum value from the combined franchise, and that's where my focus is. And when I play the management changes, that will be on top of my mind. Chances are that this is a retail institution that comes as it is. The wholesale institution that comes as it is. You bolt it on, there is straight value. A little bit of, overlap that will be there, I'll deal with it. It's not a big challenge.
Okay, that was the sum and substance of the conversation. There was a lot more, but the meaty point is that IDFC will have to buy 2% of shares of the combined entity to keep its stake at 40%. They will still need RBI approval to allow Warburg to keep between 5 and 10% stake in the merged entity. The IDFC vote translates to 15% voting. And to get the remaining, 36%, to get a 51% vote for the merger to go, they need 75% of the minority shareholders to vote in favor of the deal. And finally, in terms of CASA, 3% after merger, priority sector, very big advantage, because 45% of Capital First's assets will qualify. So they will be plus on priorities sector. And finally, there will be synergies in terms of cost of money coming down for Capital First, but retail liabilities will be the issue. We'll take a break on that note. We are coming back more on stock markets and on commodity markets.